You know what? I almost asked. I almost said, where's my hymnal? That's good. Did I get you one? No, I mean, I was like, no, because I knew I had one. I was just like, where would I get it? Yep.
Thank you. Good morning, and welcome to Third Church, New York City. Let's begin by singing hymn number 206. I'll read the first verse. O God, our Father, Mother, Love, purge thou our hearts from sin, that in thy radiancy divine, we may with eyes undimmed define thy will, reality. Hymn number 206. I'll read from the Bible, King James Version. Psalms. The Lord loveth judgment and forsaketh not his saints. They are preserved forever. The righteous shall inherit the land and dwell therein forever. The mouth of the righteous speaketh wisdom, and his tongue talketh of judgment. The law of his God is in his heart. None of his steps shall slide. Wait on the Lord and keep his way, and he shall exalt thee to inherit the land. Mark the perfect man and behold the upright, for the end of that man is peace. Let's pray for the congregation first in silence. Then we'll pray together the Lord's Prayer. I'll read the spiritual interpretation given in the Christian Science textbook.
Our Father, which art in heaven.
Our Father, Mother, God, all harmonious.
hallowed be thy name.
Adorable One.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy kingdom is come. Thou art ever present.
Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven.
Enable us to know, as in heaven, so on earth, God is omnipotent, supreme.
Give us this day our daily bread.
Give us grace for today. Feed the famished affections.
And forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors.
And love is reflected in love.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
And God leadeth us not into temptation, but delivereth us from sin, disease, and death.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever.
For God is infinite, all power, all life, truth, love, over all, and all. Let's sing hymn number 329. The heavens declare the glory of Him who made all things. Each day repeats the story. Each night its tribute brings to earth's remotest border. His mighty power is known. In beauty, grandeur, order, His handiwork is shown. Hymn number 329.
Thank you.
This church is a branch of the Mother Church, the first church of Christ Scientist in Boston, Massachusetts. We hold Sunday services at 11 a.m. and Wednesday testimony meetings at 7:30 p.m. The Wednesday testimony meeting includes singing hymns, reading from the Bible and the Christian Science textbook, and the opportunity to hear how people are living what they are learning from their study of Christian Science. We also have services in Spanish, Sundays at 1 p.m., and Wednesdays at 5:30 p.m. Services are held online and in person, and all are welcome. Third Church offers Sunday school classes online and in person for children and teens. These free one-hour classes are held each Sunday. At Sunday school, students learn how much God loves them and cares for them. They also learn about the Bible characters and lessons and the healing power of truth. For more information on times and classes, please send us an email, thirdchurch@thirdchurchnyc.com. Third Church maintains a reading room on the first floor of this building. The reading room provides a quiet place for prayer and study. Here you may purchase books and recordings on Christian Science. The reading room has the latest issues of the Christian Science Monitor, an award-winning international news weekly, available to read or purchase. Reading room hours are Monday through Friday from 1 to 4 p.m. Third Church invites you to an online Easter talk titled Daily Resurrection, given by Michael Muslin. The talk will be live streamed only on April 15th at 7:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on our website, thirdchurchnyc.com. Check this website for updates and for instructions on how to join by telephone. The solo, sung by Jenny Lynn Stewart, is titled Satisfied. The words are by Mary Baker Eddy. The music is by James G. McDermott.
Thank you.
Thank you. Friends, the Bible and the Christian Science textbook are our only preachers. We shall now read scriptural texts and their correlative passages from our denominational textbook. These comprise our sermon. The canonical writings, together with the word of our textbook, corroborating and explaining the Bible texts in their spiritual import and application to all ages, past, present, and future, constitute a sermon undivorced from truth, uncontaminated, and unfettered by human hypotheses, and divinely authorized. Today's sermon can be found on page 52 of the full text edition of the Christian Science Quarterly and page 52 of the citation edition. The subject is reality. The golden text is from Psalms. Blessed art thou, O Lord. Open thou mine eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of thy law. The responsive reading is from Isaiah and Psalms. Arise, shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee.
For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness the people. But the Lord shall arise upon thee, and his glory shall be seen upon thee.
Lift up thine eyes round about, and see.
The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork.
The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple.
The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes.
The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether.
More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold, sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb.
Moreover, by them is thy servant warned, and in keeping of them there is great reward.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. The following citations comprise our sermon. The Bible, Psalms. God is the Lord, which hath showed us light. Deuteronomy. Ascribe ye greatness unto our God. He is the rock. His work is perfect, for all his ways are judgment. A God of truth and without iniquity, just and right is he. Isaiah. Look unto me, and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God, and there is none else. Genesis. And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. 1 Corinthians. What man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man, but the spirit of God.
I'll read from The Science and Health with Key to the Scriptures by Mary Baker Eddy. All reality is in God and his creation, harmonious and eternal. That which he creates is good, and he makes all that is made. Therefore, the only reality of sin, sickness, or death is the awful fact that unrealities seem real to human erring belief until God strips off their disguise. They are not true because they are not of God. The spiritual reality is the scientific fact in all things. The spiritual fact, repeated in the action of man and the whole universe, is harmonious and is the ideal of truth. Spiritual facts are not inverted. The opposite, discord, which bears no resemblance to spirituality, is not real. To grasp the reality and order of being in its science, you must begin by reckoning God as the divine principle of all that really is. Spirit, life, truth, love combine as one and are the scriptural names for God. All substance, intelligence, wisdom, being, immortality, cause, and effect belong to God. These are his attributes, the eternal manifestations of the infinite divine principle, love. No wisdom is wise but his wisdom. No truth is true. No love is lovely. No life is life but the divine. No good is but the good God bestows. The true understanding of God is spiritual. Reality is spiritual, harmonious, immutable, immortal, divine, eternal. Nothing unspiritual can be real, harmonious, or eternal.
Ecclesiastes. The words of the preacher, the son of David, king in Jerusalem. Vanity of vanities, saith the preacher. Vanity of vanities, all is vanity. I made me great works. I builded me houses. I planted me vineyards. I made me gardens and orchards, and I planted trees in them of all kinds of fruits. I gathered me also silver and gold, and of the peculiar treasures of kings and of the provinces. So I was great, and increased more than that which were before me in Jerusalem. Then I looked on all the works that my hands had wrought, and on the labor that I had labored to do, and behold, all was vanity and vexation of spirit, and there was no profit under the sun. Then I saw that wisdom excelleth folly, as far as light excelleth darkness. For God giveth to a man that is good in his sight wisdom and knowledge and joy. 2 Corinthians. For we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal.
Take away wealth, fame, and social organizations, which weigh not one jot in the balance of God, and we get clearer views of principle. What is termed material sense can report only a mortal, temporary sense of things, whereas spiritual sense can bear witness only to truth. To material sense, the unreal is the real until this sense is corrected by Christian science. Spiritual sense, contradicting the material senses, involves intuition, hope, faith, understanding, fruition, reality. Material sense expresses the belief that mind is in matter. This human belief, alternating between a sense of pleasure and pain, hope and fear, life and death, never reaches beyond the boundary of the mortal or the unreal. When the real is attained, which is announced by science, joy is no longer a trembler, nor is hope a cheat. Befogged in error, the error of believing that matter can be intelligent for good or evil, we can catch clear glimpses of God only as the mists disperse, or as they melt into such thinness that we perceive the divine image in some word or deed, which indicates the true idea, the supremacy and reality of good, the nothingness and unreality of evil. As vapor melts before the sun, so evil would vanish before the reality of good. One must hide the other. How important, then, to choose good as the reality.
Isaiah. And the eyes of them that see shall not be dim, and the ears of them that hear shall hearken. Luke. And John, calling unto him, two of his disciples sent them to Jesus, saying, Art thou he that should come, or look we for another? When the men were come unto him, they said, John Baptist hath sent us unto thee, saying, Art thou he that should come, or look we for another? And in that same hour he cured many of their infirmities and plagues and of evil spirits, and to unto many that were blind he gave sight. Then Jesus answering said unto them, Go your way, and tell John what things ye have seen and heard, how that the blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, to the poor the gospel is preached. And blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. Matthew. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on an hill cannot be hid. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven.
Jesus is the name of the man who, more than all other men, has presented Christ, the true idea of God, healing the sick and the sinning, and destroying the power of death. Divine truth, life, and love gave Jesus authority over sin, sickness, and death. Our Master taught no mere theory, doctrine, or belief. It was the divine principle of all real being which he taught and practiced. His proof of Christianity was no form or system of religion and worship, but Christian Science, working out the harmony of life and love. Jesus sent a message to John the Baptist, which was intended to prove beyond a question that the Christ had come. Go your way and tell John what things ye have seen and heard, how that the blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, to the poor the gospel is preached. In other words, tell John what the demonstration of divine power is, and he will at once perceive that God is the power in the messianic work. Jesus gave the true idea of being, which results in infinite blessings to mortals. The realization that all inharmony is unreal brings objects and thoughts into human view in their true light, and presents them as beautiful and immortal. Harmony in man is as real and immortal as in music. Discord is unreal and mortal.
John. And as Jesus passed by, he saw a man which was blind from his birth. And his disciples asked him, saying, Master, who did sin, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, Neither hath this man sinned nor his parents, but that the works of God should be made manifest in him. I must work the works of him that sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. When he had thus spoken, he spat on the ground and made clay of the spittle, and he anointed the eyes of the blind man with the clay, and said unto him, Go, wash in the pool of Siloam, which is by interpretation sent. He went his way, therefore, and washed, and came seeing.
Jesus demonstrated the inability of corporeality, as well as the infinite ability of spirit, thus helping erring human sense to flee from its own convictions and seek safety in divine science. Jesus' demonstrations sift the chaff from the wheat and unfold the unity and the reality of good, the unreality, the nothingness of evil. If sickness is real, it belongs to immortality. If true, it is a part of truth. Would you attempt with drugs or without to destroy a quality or condition of truth? But if sickness and sin are illusions, the awakening from this mortal dream or illusion will bring us into health, holiness, and immortality. This awakening is the forever coming of Christ, the advanced appearing of truth, which casts out error and heals the sick. This is the salvation which comes through God, the divine principle, love, as demonstrated by Jesus. Sight, hearing, all the spiritual senses of man are eternal. They cannot be lost. Their reality and immortality are in spirit and understanding, not in matter, hence their permanence. When we come to have more faith in the truth of being than we have in error, more faith in spirit than in matter, more faith in living than in dying, more faith in God than in man, then no material suppositions can prevent us from healing the sick and destroying error.
Luke, fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. John, there cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink, for his disciples were gone away unto the city to buy meat. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee a living water. Whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again, but whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. The woman saith unto him, sir, give me this water, that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. Jesus saith unto her, go, call thy husband and come hither. The woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus said unto her, thou hast well said, I have no husband. For thou hast had five husbands, and he who thou now hast has not thy husband. In thou saidest thou truly. The woman saith unto him, sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Jesus saith unto her, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. The woman said unto him, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he is come, he will tell us all things. Jesus saith unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. The woman then left her water pot and went her way into the city, and saith to the men, come, see a man which told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ? Then they went out of the city and came unto him.
Jesus demonstrated Christ. He proved that Christ is the divine idea of God, the Holy Ghost, or Comforter, revealing the divine principle, love, and leading into all truth. Christ, as the spiritual or true idea of God, comes now as of old, preaching the gospel to the poor, healing the sick, and casting out evils. Let us learn of the real and eternal and prepare for the reign of spirit, the kingdom of heaven, the reign and rule of universal harmony, which cannot be lost nor remain forever unseen. Through discernment of the spiritual opposite of materiality, even the way through Christ, truth, man will reopen with the key of divine science, the gates of paradise, which human beliefs have closed, and will find himself unfallen, upright, pure, and free, not needing to consult almanacs for the probabilities either of his life or of the weather, not needing to study brainology to learn how much of a man he is. When speaking of God's children, not the children of men, Jesus said, "The kingdom of God is within you." That is, truth and love reign in the real man, showing that man in God's image is unfallen and eternal. Jesus beheld in science the perfect man, who appeared to him where sinning mortal man appears to mortals. In this perfect man, the Savior saw God's own likeness, and this correct view of man healed the sick. Thus, Jesus taught that the kingdom of God is intact, universal, and that man is pure and holy. Millions of unprejudiced minds, simple seekers for truth, weary wanderers athirst in the desert, are waiting and watching for rest and drink. Give them a cup of cold water in Christ's name and never fear the consequences.
Ephesians. Ye were sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. Unto the Lord. Wherefore be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. Isaiah. Then shall thy light break forth as the morning, and thine health shall spring forth speedily, and thy righteousness shall go before thee. The glory of the Lord shall be thy reward. Servant, whom I have chosen.
Mortals must look beyond fading, finite forms if they would gain the true sense of things. Where shall the gaze rest but in the unsearchable realm of mind? We must look where we would walk, and we must act as possessing all power from him in whom we have our being. Let us rejoice that we are subject to the divine powers that be. The real man being linked by science to his maker, mortals need only turn from sin and lose sight of mortal selfhood to find Christ, the real man, and his relation to God, and to recognize the divine sonship. So far as the scientific statement as to man is understood, it can be proved and will bring to light the true reflection of God, the real man, or the new man, as St. Paul has it. If the disciple is advancing spiritually, he is striving to enter in. He constantly turns away from material sense and looks toward the imperishable things of spirit. If honest, he will be in earnest from the start and gain a little each day in the right direction, till at last he finishes his course with joy. During the collection in the church, online contributions can be made through our website, thirdchurchnyc.com. Let's sing hymn number 241. O Spirit, source of light, thy grace is unconfined. Dispel the gloomy shades of night, reveal the light of mind. Hymn number 241. I'll read the scientific statement of being from the Christian Science textbook. There is no life, truth, intelligence, nor substance in matter. All is infinite mind and its infinite manifestation, for God is all in all. Spirit is immortal truth. Matter is mortal error. Spirit is the real and eternal. Matter is the unreal and temporal. Spirit is God, and man is his image and likeness. Therefore, man is not material. He is spiritual.
Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself, even as he.
Salvation belongeth unto the Lord. Thy blessing is upon thy people. Amen.